Yo, what's up? This is Patrick.
This is Stan.
And in this video, we're going to begin the journey of building a modern lakehouse data warehouse. Stay tuned. If you find this for the very first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date from all the videos from both Adam, Stijn, and myself. All right, first, before we get into this lakehouse, modern lakehouse data warehouse, why don't you do a quick introduction of who you are?
My name is Stijn Wynants. I'm from Belgium. Used to be an MVP and now working for Microsoft for about 3.5 years. Work for a thing called Azure Fast Track. So we basically help customers get engaged with Azure, move to Azure, and basically become fans of Azure. We're a free service and it's a lot of fun to work with. And I work in the data and AI section, so I focus mainly on helping people get started with data warehousing, data lake, and all that stuff. And that's why I'm here today.
I know how to build a data warehouse. I've been building data warehouses since most people were little bitty kids, and I put them in my SQL server, and that's where everything went. I use SSIS, and I loaded it right into my data warehouse. What's the difference? What is this modern lakehouse?
So basically what we're going to do is we're not going to work with sort of a relational database system. What we're going to work with is a data lake, and that data lake is basically going to handle all of our data coming in, moving through different folders, and then basically putting sort of a transaction layer around that. And we're all going to do that in Azure Synapse Analytics.
But it's not much different from my traditional data warehouse, right? I have to extract some data. I need to land some data. I'm going to have to transform or clean up that data. And then we'll put it somewhere, and probably not what I'm used to, a relational database, but it'll go somewhere where people can access it and query it and use it for analytics and things like that, right?
Yeah, that's the main idea. So basically nothing really changes, but it's just a different way of tackling it. More scalable and less effort for you.
So typically when I start, I'm going to use some tool to extract my data. And so old school Patrick, because I'm old school, I use SQL Server Integration Services, but we're not using the integration services. So we're going to use something new. Well, not new, but I guess new to most of our viewers. And we're going to use this thing called a pipeline inside of Synapse Studio. And what's unique about this, and I used to do this back with SSIS, what's unique about this is we're going to make this completely dynamic.
What I want to do is basically build a pipeline and only build one pipeline, keeping it low code, one pipeline that does one connection that loads all my stuff in one go.
All right, so you guys know what we like to do. Instead of all this talking, let's do what? Let's head over to Stijn's laptop.
We will open up our Synapse Workspace Studio. As you can see, we're here in the Home tab, and then we'll click on this little pipeline over here called Integrate. Once we're in the Integrate, I want to create a new pipeline. Basically, this pipeline is going to drive my copy of my data from my source systems to that lake. And what I'm going to do is just click here, New Pipeline, and get started. First thing I want to do is basically make a connection to my on-premises SQL Server. For this case, I basically created an Azure SQL DB. And how you can do that is basically using a lookup. You can find that under the General tab over here, and then there's something called lookup. Just drag it in. So let's call this get on-premises tables. And we go to the settings of that and we just say a source data set. Let's create a new one because we haven't created anything before. And also make sure that you check this first row only. Like you don't want the first row only, you want the full data set. Click on new. You can just type in the search bar here, Azure SQL DB, continue. We're also going to select a new linked service. Once we're in that linked service, we're going to call this our SQL Server connection. And from here, you can see that you can basically select account selection method. You can say from Azure subscription, just directly connect to some in your Azure subscription. But as I told you before, I want to make this as dynamic as I can. So I'm going to say enter manually. I will head over here for authentication type. SQL authentication is really not the most secure way of connecting. So I'm just going to use system managed identity. This basically is a managed identity of your Synapse workspace. This is basically your application Synapse connecting to your SQL server. And you can basically add it as a user in there.
So one thing I found when I was walking through the steps that you provided me was that when I used that method of authentication, I needed to head over to my SQL database and create a user and grant that user access to read from that database. So that's some steps that you need to follow. If you guys are interested, if everyone's interested, let us know in the comments below, and I'm happy to do a short video to show you how to do that. All right, back to your laptops then.
Very important, if you want to parameterize this, scroll down a little bit and you can see parameters here. What we're going to do here is we basically need a fully qualified domain name and a database name. So we're going to get two parameters for that. Logical server name and database name. Keep them string, keep the default values, that's okay. And then when you click into the fully qualified domain name, there's something called add dynamic content. You can now click the logical server name, just click it and it automatically fills it in. Same with the database name, add dynamic content, and click on the database name, create. Once you've created this, make sure that you name your dataset something proper. Let's call this one generic table for SQL. You don't need to select a specific table, just press OK. And now you can see that we basically created that first dataset. That was the linked service and the dataset. So a linked service is always linked to a dataset. We need to open up that dataset again, because now you will see it will ask for two values here, which have not been filled in yet. We need to do another parameter, but this time not on the linked service level, but on the dataset level. So we head over to parameters. We do two new ones, same thing, logical server name, database name. We go back to the connection part, click on it, add dynamic content, logical server name, and then database name. And if we then head back over to our pipeline, you will now see that you can basically get that logical server name over here in the dataset properties where you can fill it in. Now, to fill that in over here, we need a parameter on the level of our pipeline. Now, you can't see any pipeline level parameters. It's just because you have to click anywhere else. You get parameters here. You do two new ones, logical server name and also database name. So once we've created those parameters on the pipeline level, we can go back to our lookup and then just fill in those on our dataset level. So you can add dynamic content, logical server name, and over here, the database pipeline parameter. The cool thing is you can say table, stored procedure, or query. In our case, we're going to use a query. You can basically just write select star from sys.tables, and you can basically just select everything from that metadata table and just get all those tables in there.
This is, to me, one of the most exciting parts of this, because I can basically dynamically build a list using a query or maybe even a stored procedure that provides me with all the objects that I want to interact with in my source system. So maybe there's 3 tables, maybe there's 100 tables. I don't need to create a data set for each one of those tables. I create a single data set and it'll use that query to dynamically provide the list for the next step that we're going to do in this process.
And the cool thing is you can also add dynamic content there. So basically you could parameterize that as well.
Wow. This is blowing my mind. It's going to be so easy, because if you think about, people have so many disparate source systems that they need to do. They can literally say, you know, if this is Oracle and SQL, create one of these pipelines for each one and then provide that dynamic query or stored procedure, whatever it is, to iterate through those objects that they want to extract data from. This is amazing. All right, Stijn, let's keep going.
What we're going to do now is we're going to use the output of this lookup in an iteration. You can see on the left-hand side, you got iteration and conditionals. We're going to use for each. For each basically means we're going to loop on every item that's in there. So loop all tables. What you can do now is just link it over here and then just basically go over here on the settings tab. And then you can say sequential. Sequential would mean that you go one by one, but we basically want to do this in batch. Default batch count is 20. The max batch count is about 50. We're going to leave them default, so it would do about 20 iterations of this pipeline at the same time. But a cool thing here is the item part. So what we need is add dynamic content here. We're going to say, okay, give me the output of that activity. This one, you can see here that you get on-premises value array, and that's basically what we need. So if you just put output there, you basically only get the output. It's a JSON file. But if you specify the value, that will be the result of our select star from sys.tables. It's a complete list. So once we've done this, press OK, and then we can go and head into an activity inside that for each loop. So if we just open this one up, you can see that you're now inside that context of that for each loop. You can just drag in something to basically copy the data from our on-prem system to our data lake. And the easy way to do that is using the copy data task.
So we're creating like the staging area, it sounds like, or our landing zone, whatever you want to call it. So we're going to extract the data from our source system. And instead of old school way landing into a database, we're going to put this data in our data lake. And then we can use that later to do some additional transformations upstream to clean that data up and things like that.
In most cases, in that landing zone, you just want to get the data as it is. You just want to push everything over. You can filter and take less columns later, but basically in that raw layer, that landing zone layer, you want that data to come in as pure as possible.
This is our first touch of that data. We'll worry about business rules and slowly changing dimensions and facts, all that stuff later. All right, back to your laptop.
Yeah, we've got now this copy task called on premises. And you see here that we have two things, a source and a sink. link. Now, a source is the query you're going to select from, which is our SQL server, of course. Sync is the destination you're going to write to, and that destination is going to be a data lake. Let's go back to the source first. We already created a data set called generic table. So let's go and get that generic query back. And now we can just basically reuse that data set. I already have created that data set. I don't need to create a new data set because I can completely parameterize this data set. Logical server name will be, again, the one that's on the pipeline level. So that's this one. And the database name will be also the same. It already passes through from the pipeline because we're still in the same pipeline. And then you can go query. So what we can do over here is click add dynamic content. And now we're going to build our query based on the input we get from the iteration of the for each.
So basically what we're going to do is say select something from each one of the tables.
Yep. Just a very quick note on this part. Any column name that you're going to specify here is case sensitive. So I'm just going to paste in the one that I prepared for this specific video. Mm-hmm. And the schema name and the table name, they're case sensitive. If I would use a small t for table name, it would not work.
This query right here, and it's literally going to run the select statement from each one of the schema table, the objects that we provided.
And the lookup.
Yeah, so it's going to iterate through the items provided by that lookup. Okay, yeah.
Press OK. Let's head back over to our sync. And the sync, we're going to use basically the default one we have. This one is called Data Lake Destination. And the Data Lake is already connected to our Synapse when you created that Synapse Studio. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to open the data set and basically link it to a workspace default storage. Then I specify a parameter, one for the container, one for the pod. And in my connection, I'm going to add that as a dynamic content into my file pod, so the container name and also my pod name. Note that I'm not entering any file name. We're working with folders, we're not working with files. It's really not a good practice to work with file names inside the data lake. And so once this is there, we're basically done. This pipeline can now connect to any SQL server, get all the tables, loop them, and load them to my data lake.
So basically, I have a lookup. The lookup's gonna go to my source system. It could be any of the connectors that are available in the pipeline. And then I'm gonna provide a query that's gonna say, give me these objects, these tables, these views, whatever they are. And then it's gonna loop through each one. And then that dynamic query that you created is gonna say, select all the columns from that table or whatever the object is, drop it into the data lake that I created. And then it'll just keep doing it for each one of those objects. And it's not hard coded, it's completely dynamic. I can reuse this for any SQL server or whatever the source is.
So you can basically just push it over.
Wow, that's remarkable. That's remarkable. Now, this is the first video in the series. Stijn is actually writing these blog posts up. And so if you want to get more details, more information, if you want to walk through this, I know this is a whirlwind of all the things that could be done. If you want more details, go read the blog posts and, you know, post some comments there, post some comments here. But before we leave, there's one more thing. How do I run this? How do I test this out to make sure it works?
Let's head back over to the laptop.
Okay.
What you can do is you can basically say trigger now, or create a trigger that basically makes it in a scheduled way, or debug. Okay. And debug is just going to do a certain runtime and it will run and give you like, this is working, this is not working, but more in a limited way. Trigger is going to run in the background, and then while you're doing that, you can make changes to your actual pipeline and stuff like that.
When it's all done, what does it look like in my data lake?
So let me just start it over here. I'm going to head over to my data lake, which is under the data tab. And then we've got here data lake storage gen 2, synapse in a day, got our landing zone, and inside that landing zone, we've got the database name, which we entered. We've got our schema, and then we've got our customer table.
Wow.
And then we've got our Parquet files underneath it, which we don't care what name it is.
So if I had 18 SQL servers, I can use this and dynamically switch the parameters to go from each one of those SQL servers. Wow. Mind blown. Thank you so much, Stijn. This has been a work in progress, and we're not finished. There's going to be several additional videos to continue to build on this series. All right. What do you guys think? You got any questions? You got any comments? You know what to do. Post it in the comments below. If it's your first time visiting the Guy in the Cube channel, hit that subscribe button. If you like the video, give me a big thumbs up. As always, from Adam
and Stijn
and myself, thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.